Today we're going to be going over shucking a Seagate external hard drive. Two things that you want to keep in mind as you're doing this. One, if you're shucking your drive, you need to keep all the internal parts in here, and you also need to put it back in its box, most likely so you can keep track of it. There's a serial number on the bottom of this particular unit. That serial number is matched to the drive inside. If you do run into a situation where you need to RMA it, you are going to have the proper drive to go inside the USB enclosure. An RMA will not happen with just the drive alone. If you call them, they may be able to give you that information. I have a video that I'll be releasing shortly where I go through that entire process of how I got them to give me that information and got a take from them on what their stance was as far as USB shuck drives and how they were returnable. Check the links below. If you see the two ports here, the power and the USB connector port, the side that's closest to this, the top, is the side that you can actually pry open. The side that's down here and the back side are all one piece. And so part of what they evaluate on a return drive is the level of damage to the drive. So if we absolutely just hack this thing to pieces, especially this part down here, that could be something that we just want to avoid. If you're shucking a bunch of drives at once, keep all the parts for that particular drive inside the drive, just gently close the lid back on, put that back in the box, keep the box. That'll make your RMA, if you need to do one, very, very effective. So being able to get a start, I like to use a really rigid edged, sharp, very sharp blade. And so this will not bend and break. So you might be tempted to use a sponger to get this started. This is what a sponger ends up looking like after trying to run through just a couple drives. As you can see, it just eats up the edges. Once you get it started, a sponger is not a bad tool to use, but to get it going, that's really the wrong tool. As well, a credit card is just not going to be able to do the digging in that we need and be able to apply the force we need to get that torque to give it an initial break. If we look at the backside of some tweezers, these are actually not bad at all. Although these tweezers in particular are slightly fatter than you would typically like. These are excellent once you get it started. However, to get it started, not the best. In my opinion, really sharp, really firm-edged blade on a knife is the best way. The next thing you want to do is you want to start by just kind of sliding into the groove back and forth with a knife. And so you can see by doing it right here in this spot, it just slides right in. That's because there's no teeth in this exact spot for it to grab onto. So the next thing you can do is you can actually either take the back of your tweezers, you can take a sponger, or in our case, we're going to use this Petco card and start by driving that in there to hold that open. And once you've got that started, then you can use it to protect the base of it. So you want to get that in and then come back with the knife again. And this time, give it a little bit of a pop up right on the near side edge. And so we've broken up this edge here. This edge now is a good place to start with how we work around the case. And so using the card to protect what's underneath it, just pull that up a little bit extra there. So kind of wiggle it back and forth to pop that out. And so now we've got a really good start on the edge here. And we'll just wedge this down in there. And that extra torque will help us as we move along. And if you are using a knife, you of course want to be very careful not to cut yourself. And so by this time, we've pretty much got it to the point where we can pull most of the drive up. And it's best to kind of push this down at a 45 degree angle to not break the clips that are holding it in place, but instead to just pop them out. And so as you can see this edge here, we've got a really clean edge going on it. And on the inside, we've got very, very minimal marring and scratching on the edges. So, I mean, you'd be pretty hard pressed to tell once you recase it, if you do have a problem, that you have an issue at all. So the next thing that we need to do is kind of pop this a little bit down and then get the drive out. So the drives are held in by gravity, so just kind of put your hand underneath it, pull this out, and just give it a couple shakes. We'll take the little rubber feetsies off. I also need to save these studs. And so this appears to be important also. The PCB that connects here has got one screw in it. It also has its own serial number. So I have kept all of mine together as best as possible. I recommend you do the same. It was a bit of a disaster to find, with all of the Shuck drives that I had, the proper components that went together. But if you know, the numbers here are not going to match the serial number that you have here, and they will neither one match the serial number you have here. This serial number and this serial number do not match. So you RMA based off of the drive serial number. You will not be able to RMA based off of your just hard disk alone or this serial number. So you need to keep all these components together if you're ever to have a hope of getting an RMA. So I like to just put them all back in, put all the screws back in, the peggy feet things, and then just gently, not fully, close that just in the middle. And now we've got our drive ready to go. All right. So be sure to hit like, subscribe, and also hit that notification bell, and you can follow up with my RMA process that I had where I got on the phone, talked to Seagate, and what they had to say as far as their stance on Shuck drives and the returnability of Shuck drives and the criteria you have to meet to be able to return under an RMA a Shuck drive.